Considering together when the digital is the more effective mode and when in-person interactions support learning best, finding the right mix for each context and group based on goals of the group, these discussions bring this diverse group together, share pictures of practice, and learn from one another, and I find this one of the richest spaces each year for thinking through how we shape 21st century education. Any community that is brought together around a passion for student learning, and any community that is brought together around a commitment to using digital modalities for expanded access, empowerment, engagement, radical collaboration, and reflection will be a joyful and vibrant place to make connections. For Bryn Mawr, this conference has been a phenomenal way to connect with colleagues across roles and across institutions to forge deeply rewarding collaborations that continue for us to evolve and bear fruit. In preparing to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Roopika, Risam, I encountered delightful connections between her pathways and mine, and this got me thinking about the opportunity that we have as we meet new colleagues here and reconnect with folks who we've seen in past contexts and years, and to sort of think about how we listen and how we share our stories to find the places where we have something in common that we can build on. So there are three connections I discovered as I was reading through Roopika's writings and listening to her haystack talk. So at a very basic level, our academic backgrounds are not dissimilar. PhD in English, digital humanities, which back in the day we called humanities computing, and then a focus on gender, sexuality, cultural post-colonial studies, and social justice work. More particularly, emerging a little bit into the uncanny, we teach a first year seminar on monsters. So I think that how the monsters tell us something about our cultures and ourselves as humans. And then on a very kind of personal note, which I shared with her, because she's a faculty member, as you know, at Salem State University in Massachusetts, educating future teachers. My wife was enrolled in a blended learning master's program at Salem State, where she was thinking about career change and study to be a K-12 sort of librarian that does sort of digital media and information literacy support. So I was very energized by the range of Roopika's writings and courses and presentation topics and by the web of topics she leads. I wanted to mention two kinds of spectrums that are represented in Roopika's work and very much in the focus of this conference as it continues to evolve. So we have long celebrated the spectrum of diverse roles that are represented in blended learning projects at the course level, at the program level, at the institutional level, so students, faculty, academic technology specialists, library colleagues, department chairs, provosts, all coming together to think through how do we give students better opportunities to learn in meaningful and engaged and helpful ways. In these collaborations, everyone is bringing some form of knowledge, and everyone is learning and building together. And this makes blended learning spaces that inherently honor diversity and democracy in some ways a special place to really rethink traditional ways of working together in the academy while building on the best of what we learn in the disciplines about how we think, how we learn, how we precipitously forget, how we remember, and so on. Another continuum I think that's very dear to our hearts here at Bryn Mawr is the range from blended learning and educational technology generally, where the emphasis is on the learning and teaching practices, to the digital humanities and digital scholarship more generally, where the emphasis is more on research and scholarly inquiry. So I think one of the things we've really thought a lot about here is that these things are not different in kind, right? They really, at their core, often grow from one another. So a multi-year, multi-site digital humanities digital scholarship project might involve a course-based project at its outset, where students are coming together to learn something by way of this active learning engagement that might grow into a larger kind of a digital humanities or digital scholarship project. Similarly, a faculty or student digital scholarship project may well then be brought into the classroom as a site for potential development, building facets of that project as part of the coursework. So I love very much that Roopika focuses her work at the heart of these intersections and collaborations, and the digital humanities work she does operates at many critically important levels. It is, as she writes, student-forward by design, ensuring that students are the designers and leaders of the work where they're doing their own learning and pursuing their goals. It is also a lens for interrogating projects that we're all embedded within and co-producers of in different forms. So being a part of the neoliberal U.S. university or college and thinking about what that means, the arts and sciences and the dialogue among disciplines and about those differences and convergences, the public discourse around the work of education generally and the particular communities who seek and deliver education. Roopika asks questions situated with care in the local and the global historical and economic, psychological, and social contexts in which we work. The writings and presentation have sparked my enthusiasm and my thinking. And I look forward to your presentation this morning, to the many conversations that will no doubt follow, and to the rich and poetic sessions that we'll have over the next days where we're gathered together, thinking through how one of those models and experiences may inform our own experiments and practices. It is my pleasure to thank you for her work and to welcome her here to the Blended Learning Congress to talk with us about networks of pedagogy, notes for this decolonized.
Producing knowledge is a particular challenge when working with my students. It's an To give you a sense of our student demographics, which sheds some light on where we're coming from, we draw primarily from the North Shore of Massachusetts, which is the area north of Boston. There's a lot of economic, racial, and ethnic diversity in the area, so you'll find everything from towns that are 98% white, median incomes around $200,000, and then you'll see cities where median income is around $40,000, and the high numbers Latinx population and other populations, and so the other towns and cities that tend to populate our student body at some stage, so they show up in the university, are not coming from the major festival towns. The commission of private colleges are achieving mass honors. Instead, we're pulling from the working class and the middle class communities that are surrounding the area. So 40% of our students are first-generation college students, and 35% of our students are students of color. And these are students who have also been largely underserved by the public school systems where they've grown up. So Massachusetts, for example, was cited by the Justice Department for failing to meet the needs of English language learners. So now we're in the middle of a major initiative of public schools to certify everybody with endorsement and English version, so we're not making a state mistake as it's amazing. Once it's just only about legal education a number of years ago. The other issue that's built in our students is the politics around high stakes benchmark testing. So for us, it's the MCAS, and because of the influence of MCAS and the legacy of the child left behind, we have schools that focus on teaching to the test, but not only teaching the test, literally teaching the test for weeks at a time. And my sort of other life, I'm a faculty member in school education, and this is always a problem when we send students to care for these other student teachers for their student in America, because then they have to take the test. They have to literally teach them as well as questions. So, it's no surprise that our students come to us not really seeing themselves intellectually inspired, not really having a lot of learning, particularly because we're drawn from the districts that were being labeled of 3 under a 12 behind, and so the capacity became a huge part. And so, instead, we have students come to us expecting to be passive, receptacles, and knowledge, who are ready for us to tell them what they should know. So in response, I've done this all these months, teaching as a graduate student, internationally for the time of my PhD and MRA, but it's become incredibly wonderful, and I know it's a mistake, is thinking about how blended learning is a part of a student justice commitment in education, to encourage students to see how they can tap into intellectual networks, both in the classroom and beyond, and to see themselves as having the capacity to act and to be knowledgeable users. In my experience bringing digital humanities and postcolonial studies together in the classroom, we can't divide these transformative experiences for students. And I've talked about this and written about this before as postcolonial digital pedagogy that's aimed at helping students understand the politics surrounding our production and their roles in creating the digital worlds of the 21st century. Doing so challenges the myth of the digital media that is so pervasive in conversations around pedagogy, and I'll turn to this in a minute, but it also addresses some of the contextual and conceptual obstacles of teaching postcolonial studies, and it's particularly relevant for any kind of context of teaching where your students are part of non-culture and don't really have knowledge of the context in which teaching. Through postcolonial pedagogy, students can better understand, have critical culture, and and can contribute to ongoing technological marginalization of the Global South. Through hands-on experiences that illustrate these concepts, post-colonial digital pedagogy would empower students to think about how they find their meaning in the gaps and the silences that persist. So in this approach, I draw on the classical affirmances of digital humanities for its experiential approach to student learning. As Jen indicated, we want to think about digital humanities as a context of research. And something you may want to ask about here is my experiences creating an undergraduate digital humanities research program, which I did not come to talk about today, but I can talk about it in the Q&A. So much of this attention has been on research, but digital humanities can be a rich study of pedagogy as well. This is my own teaching. For helping students understand the ongoing increments of colonial power that have shaped and continue to shape digital cultures, but thinking about what came out before and read for the definition of what it's kind of follows. It further offers a mode for training, for engaging students in acts that might contribute eventually to the decolonizing knowledge question, and helping them at the same time find agency and find their own voices. Emphasizing the role of pedagogy in his definition of digital humanities, Matthew Kirschner writes, whatever our study then, the digital humanities today is of scholarship and a pedagogy that is only visible in ways to which we can only unaccustom, a scholarship and a pedagogy that are bound up with infrastructure in ways that are deeper and more explicit than we are generally accustomed to. A scholarship and pedagogy that are collaborative and depend on diverse people and that live an active 24/7 life online. Our students are certainly part of our social media, of the people who ask us at SATS Go, will spend about 10,000 hours on video games at the time of 21. Yet they often lack the tools to engage with digital media and technology critically. They don't look beyond the surface level user experience to analyze the implications, politics, and sociocultural dynamics of technologies. By teaching students to see and intervene at the people level, though, it's easier now than ever. With the advent of so-called Web 2.0 technologies, participatory forms of digital culture have emerged, made possible by low barriers to entry for civic engagement and creative expression online. These means of the production of knowledge are available to us and to our students, but they don't want to recognize that they have access to these powerful tools, or if they do, we don't know what to do with them. So this lack of understanding continues as a fundamental challenge to the way Mark Bransky has situated the digital native, this notion that young people internet access, video games, they have some kind of intimate familiarity with technology that apparently we as instructors don't have. And this concept has so many problems with it, right? So presumes there aren't inequalities in access. It presumes that there are kind of socioeconomic, gender, and geographical dimensions that don't close one's relationship with technology or shape it. Also, the sort of reliance on natives and immigrants is indeed apparently, it's the immigrants because we are not raised in environments that are saturated with computer technologies. But I think it's also a misnomer. I mean, I'm not going to act to be then. You probably have a similar And so the first time I caught it, I was so excited. I was like, hi, I'm 9 computer science majors. We're going to do some awesome stuff.
Yeah.
students are not knowledgeable, that there is a professor who holds knowledge and students provide some knowledge. Has built a backtrack here, pyramids and counted argument. Education is perhaps more insidious and in some ways the most strictly colonialist survivals. Older systems are passing sometimes imperceptibly into neo-colonial configurations. In response, postmodal studies scholars have taken up this challenge, thinking about how we decolonize the dynamics of the classroom to challenge top-down hierarchical ones that are typically characterized teaching, especially teaching at college level. So, one of the goals of our worship pedagogy is to try and contract against politics in the classroom itself and anything active learning as well. So, it comes out of a very integrated approach to education and of course, thinking about the ways that blended learning can facilitate that move away from a banking model of education. And also away from what I was thinking called sitting on stage, which is more eye on the side kind of model. And so this way of thinking about fostering lateral rather than hierarchical networks within the context of the classroom. So keep this in mind. Into the design of these courses to encourage them to think about how they learn, to be able to find ideas and kind of projects that really excite them and useful and meaningful to their own experiences, their own education, and their own professional aspirations, and to make those decisions in the context of the course. In that video, I was mentioning that the bulk of our faculty students are actually teaching record in the various schools around North of Boston from which we're drawing our student body. And so, I see the choices that I make pedagogically as well being not only about the content of learning, but also about introducing them to different kind of teaching style than themselves may have been used to. So even actually other graduate students, of course, are also tend to be students pursuing licensure. This is because I actually coordinate that program, the undergraduate Jesuit program, and so I actually rarely teach English literature courses. I mostly teach pedagogy courses. And so when those students see me taking a lit course, they tend to want to take it, so they're going to have new methods and materials, they want to see me teach courses. So that's sort of an interesting way to influence how I thought about how I'm going to teach this class, because I'm also thinking about what I'm modeling as a kind of instructional practice. This course itself explores shifts from the oral tradition to the rise of print culture to the exciting and fluid intersection of print and digital textualities that digital media and technologies facilitated both in the global north. And it does include the question of how politics have shaped non-residual and emergent forms of sexuality with an eye towards colonialism attributed to primacy of print culture, and whether that's simply becoming reproduced in the joy of whether we can imagine more literary possibilities. Through this work material, students develop an advanced interior digital cultural literacy and awareness of how digital knowledge function is that privilege epistemology of the global north. The primary function of literacies that we're seeking to engage in this course of creativity and innovation, critical thinking and problem solving, communication and collaboration, and media literacy. These literacies I see are really essential to having students make that transformation to becoming critical users, critical makers, critical creators in our relationship to technology, and to think about how we can move from consumption to production. Engaging with literary interventions of the global south through digital humanities, students are encouraged to develop new ideas about making colonies and knowledge production, communicate them with their peers, and work together to convene and figure out what practices.
ask them to consider how virtual spaces are both facilitating and foreclosing the virtual world, and to engage these ideas iteratively through experimentation and play. I do this, of course, in two primary ways. The first is the discussion boards that we use during the weeks of my online. Our students are tasked with developing and responding to discussion questions based on the major needs of the course. We ensure that every student has a voice and regularly contributed to ongoing conversations. And it was actually just a bit typical when using a discussion board versus trying to have a discussion class. But even in the context of online coursework, students were said that they were shocked at the level of engagement that the classmates had with the course material with each other. As you can see, there's some ways where they're posting, but they're trying to put comments on themselves. And it's actually all the trying to write me.
Books and basically pulling out pieces of the different books and
chronological order of standard German.
Analysis more than digital
working on clinical case and frequency, things like that. This is the genius annotation, project annotation in Hamilton. So having been thinking about that and what does it mean to project annotation. And then also this awesome interaction, or trying to visualize with everyone from Hamilton. And so when I have them looking at these three different approaches to Hamilton, I ask that each group come up with two truths and a lie. So two things that these digital platforms make, another two things that these digital platforms do that are, or would say, are true about Hamilton based on history. And one lie that the digital platform tells, that makes it look like is a way of integrating our understanding, usable, but it's a different. And so that was a way that I had to really think about how to question some of the graph and some visualization. That is objective, and they need to understand that there is this context for it too. And also, I'm thinking about rewriting the media. That's something that I've been involved in for a while. Gone to a number of universities and media conferences, and thinking about how we increase representation and media content, particularly for communities that typically are more focused on knowledge production and continue to be so in on Wikipedia as a result of the policies surrounding the editing and writing of Wikipedia. So understanding these tasks requires students to think about how to be flexible, how to think outside of their normal frameworks that they have talked about, how they think about tasks, and also think about being inventive, also about developing an awareness and relationship between the kinds of ideas that could come out of blue sky thinking from limitless thinking and imagine the possibilities that you could conceive of without worrying about logistics and visibility, and then also thinking about what happens when you want to implement a project. And kind of interesting relationship between these are our center of the 21st century awareness as well. This work also encourages students to have a healthy relationship towards failure, to see failure as a learning opportunity, and understand that being able to cultivate longer term goals, any realm, but also in terms of digital knowledge production, requires being able to evaluate, being able to adjust and respond to feedback and obstacles. And so what I actually did is, after all of the CMLA implementations, to write a reflection paper in which I could keep in track of how the hands-on experiments influence their approach to the main course team. So by the end of the semester, I had a record of that. And because this is collaborative work, it also really strengthened the pedagogical network within the classroom as students were thinking through the stages of knowledge production and their relationship to it. And so, to give you a sense of what we're doing alongside with this, we were reading a lot about digital culture, digital digitality, and we're reading some of the colonial novels that felt like were really in conversation. I mean, novels and not other texts, but were in conversation with digital culture. So, one example of a novel we read was on Sam Rushdie's event for our life, which is a video game, and Roopika's cultural collection of the Honey, which is self-published, which got a lot of acclaim by some of the media. So one of them is about how the publishing industry kind of plays into the question of whose voices get powers within the individual cultures, and to think critically about cultural formations of both the world north and the world south. I also didn't want to, because we're doing so much hands-on work experimentation, I didn't really want the students to feel like they had to sit down and write a seminar paper in response to the material, of course. So again, drawing on the influence of critical making in this class, and particularly inspired by the way digital humanists think about craft knowledge or the kinds of knowledge that emerges from hands-on work, I actually asked students to kind of create their final project and create some kind of multimodal
One was a video game about whether digital culture killed literacy. This section, this one, because this is one I can actually eat. Another one I just need to do a game, can get past the 7-year-old. But this is actually a joke. A student did an essay generally incompetent slides with absolutely no narrative text that was intended to both represent media shifts from oral culture, oral tradition, print culture, and also to incorporate critiques of paywalls, from journals, from JSTOR, and kind of the influence of accessibility on scholars and books out. And a student who tried to create a representation of Robert Frost's poem, Stopping by the Woods of Snowy Evening, which was intended to deform the text in a way that was intended to allow people who are hearing impaired to feel or see the rhythm and the meter of the poem that may not be necessarily obvious just by reading it. A student who is a teacher, and I was encouraging the teachers to do something that's really useful as teachers, did a study at her school, primarily at the next school, of students and instructors looking at reading habits and their attitudes towards digital literature and print literature, and came up with her results and was actually going to be a presentation at the department. Likely your faculty, I'm listening to about how these adults can think about the decisions they're making in their own school, which is a vocational school. So this is a sort of sense of the work that I've been doing with my students and what I'm learning with the goal of both trying to get them to think beyond my global norm as this might touch about as a culture and also while getting them the changes in literature over time, and also where both of themselves might be in intervening in knowledge production. I should note that I encountered two pitfalls every time I came to put this out. The first is global culture colorblindness, global culture blindness. The students say everybody's alike, everybody's the same. That against that, looking also at how we look at different communities forming, particularly diaspora communities forming online around literature, even having been looking at some South Asian poetry, diaspora websites in the 90s, for example, getting their pushing back in the 30s. And the other is, I think this is like their pain point for the world. You know, they have not so. Access is all about, like, they don't have access, and we give them access. And that ends up in the rubber cables in the less dynamic. So the pushback against that is really important. And also the vertical things. Students reading Nigerian fashion and getting them to think about, learn more about local penetration, local penetration in that person, and challenging their perceptions of access and challenging their. The workforce to the universal. So, in this approach to pedagogy, as I put out my for you, I'm thinking about ways to interrogate the realities of digital culture with students and to attend to the presumptions that they and any of us who make about digital environments and push back against the idea that students are digital natives, that technology is automatically a democratizing force. And that technology is a tool that exists outside of the power dynamics that shape our lived experiences. And in doing so, the students have come to understand their